Welcome back everyone to theCUBE here in Palo Alto. I'm John Furrier, your host of theCUBE with Dave Vellante. 16 years of theCUBE, we've been at it, watching all the big waves. This is our featured series on robotics and AI leaders from physical AI all the way down to the data layer. We have investors, we got entrepreneurs coming through. It's a great day, of course, tonight. Big party with the NYSE and theCUBE, which has formed the Wired community, the NYSE Wired. Got a great friend of theCUBE going back to actually our early days. Kirk Dunn is now the CEO of Kurrent. He's leading an innovative company around data and in perfect position for this wave. Kirk, great to see you. And we go way back to the old days, Cloudera. When we started theCUBE, you were in charge of that organization.
Yep.
You look great, and you got a new venture.
Well, the good news is we're going to agree we all look like we haven't aged a day, right?
Yes, I'm with you on that one.
Exactly.
I had black hair, Brian
Bellman. Well, first of all, I would just say congratulations to you guys for. And I always claim you guys are the innovators of the podcast. You're the ones that did it before anybody believed that it was actually a media outlet. And the fact that you guys have been doing it, not just for 16 years, but successfully, man, hats off to you.
Appreciate it.
I appreciate
exceptional.
It. Kirk, and same to you, you've got a great career. And I want to ask you, Dave and I always talk about this as being in the arena for so long, you become kind of a historian while the current events are happening. This is kind of a generational wave here. You got chips, software, geography challenges that are transforming the role of data, which is, you know, your wheelhouse, is the central ingredient right now where all the innovation, all the infrastructure players are innovating to manage the scale for large scale data. Of course, token demand is feeding in the applications and the agents. And then the applications themselves are going to have databases. So you have every app's going to still need a database. Now there's different kinds of databases. So the whole data world is now right front and center in the value proposition. This was the promise of big data 15 years ago when you pioneered the Hadoop movement, which set the table and became kind of where the flowers grew now, and all that's happening. So now you're back where, if we can go back to 15 years and wave the magic wand, this is what it would look like right now. The big data revolution is agents, it's horizontal data. What's your
real
reflection
time
on this?
Well, it's interesting you say that because there's been a lot of moves in the data platform area for years. I mean, it started with the operational database, right? Writes, reads, that was it. And now look what we've done since Oracle, Informix, you know, DB2. And now we have companies like Snowflake, Databricks, you know, and now we're into the AI world, which is using data in different ways. There's two major movements. And one of the reasons I came back to go run a company was the movement from centralized computing to distributed computing. Everybody knows that. There's nothing interesting about that. Other than when you start to distribute compute the way it's being distributed, you now put other pressure that you didn't have in monolithic systems. Now you're distributing systems across a portfolio, and guess what you're doing? Exactly what you said, you're distributing data with those systems. So now what do you need to do? You gotta bring it back together again because you have to correlate data. The thing that we talked a lot about at Cloudera years ago was this movement from structured to basically everything was structured data. And all of a sudden, guess what showed up? Unstructured. And Hadoop was about schema on read, not schema on write. Imagine that. You're creating the structure when you're reading it. Well, that was the beginning of all sorts of things that then evolved since then, kind of motherhood and apple pie. And it exploded what we saw as the data warehousing space into the data lake, into the lake house. And of course, as we say, Databricks, Snowflake are having amazing success. But what has that whole platform done? Is that one of the things you mentioned, Dave, is really right. It has taken, how do you take origin data and deliver results in real time? And back in the day, real time was close the books in a month, close the books in a quarter.
Before you lose the customer.
Before you lose the customer. And now it's while you're swiping the credit card, if that transaction doesn't go through, you're gonna pull out the other credit card and you're gonna lose that transaction forever. And so that's point number one. Point number two is most of what we've done this thus far has been human generated. You have a business owner that has a data team, that has an analytic team, and they all look to tell the business owner what happened. We are right there where it is going to be non-human oriented. It'll be agents that'll be making decisions based on listening for streams of events and taking action with no humans being involved. And of course, what an agent says is, I already know the protocols of the data that's coming to me. If it's time series or graph or relational, you don't need to, don't do any data integration for me. When I see it, I know what it is. So here's what I want. give me native data at origin and give it to me fast. Because I'm capable of making decisions based on what my agentic program does to act. And then the thing that makes this like turbocharged is agents will then stimulate other events that will stimulate other events and other agents and other agents. And so this kind of, this move from monolithic application environment to distributed microservices to an explosion of distributed agentic workflows, like we're barely seeing it right now.
Yeah, and those microservices are large, I mean, basically hard-coded.
Yes.
Right, so they can't, you know, reform workflows on the fly.
Precisely.
That's a huge change that's coming.
And you guys talked about, when you talk about 2D to 4D, so typically when you think of a workflow, you think of a graph kind of oriented data shape. If you think about the operational database, and this has come out recently that one of the really only in advancements in operational data has been the shape of the data. Oh, okay, we need time series. Oh, we need columnar. Oh, we need graph. Oh, we need vector. So the shape of that data was changed to deliver a result downstream for a particular use case or application. Well, how about you have an agent that can read any shape of data? Because in the workflow you're talking about, oh, it's a graph workflow, so we're restricted to that. Oh, it's time series, we're restricted to that. How about a workflow that says, I can take time series, graph, columnar, relational, I'll make the decisions and return the analytic result, and I'll do it in real time.
Kirk, talk about the company you're leading, because you did a briefing with us, and it's fascinating the position you're in.
Yeah.
Kurrent, what's it about? What is the core value proposition? How do you see the market you're going after, and what's the value proposition?
Yeah, so Kurrent is an OLT database that deals with streams of events. So if you think about, this goes way back to the beginning. I mean, this is why I got really interested and turned on by it. A business occurs as a series of structured events, of ordered events. Every business, a yogurt shop, Lululemon, whatever, a stock brokerage, you know, firm. And so those events happen in a series of order. Well, what happens in the application environment is a business person says to a data architect, here's my business, I want you to build a data platform that captures my business. So great, data model, business model. The first area of dissonance in the world is the dissonance between the business owner deriving the model and the data model. Why do I say that? Because databases capture events off of an application as states. So a bunch of things occur, they write state. A bunch of other things occur, they write state. But a bunch of the things that occur don't get captured. And so what Kurrent is an append-only log-based database where we capture every single event that occurs. So one of the, Harrison Chase, the CEO of LangChain, the other day was on a podcast and he was talking about what agents will do. And this is really important to hear it this way, they will listen for events. They're not listening for data. They're listening for the events that derive the data. And so the business model is how the business runs. The data model is the architect's interpretation of how the business runs. And then the state that gets written to the database is, again, another step removed. Our argument is if a business happens as a series of ordered events, why not record it as a series of ordered events? Keep it all. Here's the kind of the key point. I always ask people, why did change data capture occur? Why did it even happen? $3 billion a year business growing at about 20% a year. It happened for this reason. An application environment writes state. And then somebody goes, hey, Dave, how did that state get to be that state? And they go, I don't really know. So let's invent CDC. And what we will do is we will capture those state changes. Here's what's interesting about that. Those state changes are still puzzle pieces. It's not a puzzle yet. And so what happens is then some data engineer takes current state, takes CDC streams, runs it downstream, and puts the puzzle back together and says, oh, it's a mountain scene. Oh, great. Well, how about if you didn't have to do any of that? How about if you recorded everything exactly the way it happened? It's like the difference between in a basketball game looking at the stat sheet versus watching the replay of the game. Oh, the Warriors won and Draymond Green had 20 rebounds and blah, 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 but it doesn't tell you the story. Well, you can actually literally replay from the events the entire story of the game so you know exactly what happened.
I do like YouTube's key plays feature, actually, by the
exactly.
way.
Exactly. Yeah, it's a good
so that
one.
Sets up a digital representation of the enterprise.
Totally.
And everything that who did what, when, where.
Totally.
And the lineage of all that.
Yeah. And there's another startup company, Chad, who is a founder of a company called Gable. And Gable basically is around to do this kind of data governance, data lineage thing. Mm-hmm. And the argument is, from origin of data, from let's say it's time series or relational, pick whatever, it doesn't matter. From the day it gets originated, all the data transformations it goes through, all the different organizations it traverses, all the different parquet files it ends up in, and then the BI tool that represents it back to the business, do you know how many steps? We call that lost in translation. And what Gable is all about is, we're going to give you the historical lineage of that data so you actually know where it derived from and where it's headed. I'll give you one other example of one of our big customers. Interesting, not a very sexy company, large automobile parts manufacturing company in Europe. And they have all this application data on one side, and they have Databricks on the other side. And what they realized was in this translation era, they were taking all this data and they were trying to recompose it to tell the story of the business. And they realized the problem is when we get down to the Databricks layer, we have no way to find our way home because it's been stepped on and changed so much. And so what they did was they stuck Kurrent in as what they call the event operating system. Because again, if a business is a series of events, then capture the data as those events and you'll derive whatever state
it
is.
So who's the buyer? Who's the principal persona that you want to target?
So we have two that we go after. So because we're a database, one is we go after, you know, application development environments. And we have people that have, it was an open source project when it started, and we have customers that literally say, and I, you know, I always say there's more than one way to do anything. So gray hair proves that things, there's no one way. But they literally tell me they will never ever build another application any other way than this way because they capture the events. They capture the entire history of their business and they can always go back. So app dev is one area we go, very natural, you know, but that's you guys know the database world can be challenging if they're used to Postgres or SQL Server. The other area is this data integration layer where we know that when you've originated data and you're not moving it, then data is stale. Why originate it if you don't move it? And so the whole streaming world has come up, which is how do you move data in real time? And so the data engineer, where we're taking data in off the operational tier, organizing it in topics, and then delivering it to downstream applications, agents, BI tools, whatever you want. And again, the key is you can find your way home. We know your source of data. And so we'll deliver those read models to others. So app dev as well as data engineering integration play.
Well, Kirk, we're super excited that you came on, and I'm super glad that we could connect. I know you got a lot going on. We're going to see you at the event tonight.
Yep.
What are you guys doing right now? Give us status of the company, levels of people. What's your focus? Are you funding?
Yep.
How's things going? How's the business model? Give a quick plug on what's happening.
Business is good. I like to tell us we're like, you know, because we're a database that streams, you know, everybody's attaching AI onto it. Although I will say, 2 weeks ago, we just released our MCP server.
Okay.
So you'll be able to use natural language to be able to say, build me an application that does this, that, and the other, and it'll build it for you. So that's very exciting. Mm-hmm. We have a number of really significant product announcements coming in the next month, so I'd love to come back and share those.
Terrific. Definitely.
A lot of those are interesting things in this ability to curate data closer to the operational estate, so you don't have to wait till it gets to the analytic estate to inquire, that you could to query the data, you might say, if I'll give you a little bit of a forewarning on what's coming. We're keeping the company lean. We've got about 140 customers. We have a 95% renewal rate. The product just works and people like it. And so this year, we've spent the last year and a half when I joined to kind of build a very advanced cloud product. We're about 50% on-prem, 50% cloud. 50% of our business is financial services. So if you think about financial services is a ledger business.
Yeah.
Well, events are a ledger business, so that's why it fits. And so this year is about getting those products fully into the market and then investing in the go-to-market and expanding that customer base.
Well, you definitely have been an AI infrastructure leader and continue to be, obviously now databases joins network compute and storage as critical infrastructure.
Huge.
And databases are tied to every application. You got graph, you got all kinds of databases. So again, the world is spun back in the front door of your world.
Well, and I say this too, because we've been around long enough to know what Oracle did was they ended up with Exadata, a data warehouse product, you know, an analytics product. What Snowflake and Databricks are doing as analytics companies, they're coming back to the operational estate. Yeah. And so the right answer is you actually have to have a portfolio of products. But here's what I would say. Is it more likely that agents will be fed from the analytic tier or they'll be fed from the source of data?
The latter, for sure.
Yeah,
totally.
Origination. And events, too, track
that's
everything.
That's the true source of truth. It's where the process logic lives.
Exactly, yeah.
That 4D map again.
It's a 4D map. We love what you guys are doing in this area. And man, we're small but mighty, but we are running with the cubes, 2D versus 4D. So we're big fans of George's work and your work
there. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great stuff. And of course, we've been tracking the programming models here and data. The layers change. The game is still the same. Innovation, real time. Gen AI has new requirements, new architectures. And of course, that's changing all aspects of the stack. The cube's bringing you all the action here in our studios in Palo. I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante. Thanks for watching.